Okay, so recording has been started. Hi, good morning to all of you. This is demonstration two for the batch which we are starting from 29th, right? The live project that we are starting from 29th of June, right? Where we're going to make the social networking site like Facebook, correct? In the earlier demo, in the first demo, I've already explained about the project, which I'm going to do again in this as well. I mean, I will be extending the explanation that what you're going to learn in this social networking site, right? Which we're going to build in Angular 7 with full stack development, where we're going to have web API, database, Angular material, Express.js, Node.js, UX, UI, Bootstrap, everything into picture. That is why it is called a full stack development, right? So what we're going to do today is we're going to see the architecture of Angular. So in the last demonstration, what I've explained is what is Angular and why we actually need it. In this session, what our focus would be that how Angular basically work, how everything work behind the scene, what is the architecture of Angular, and then we'll quickly jump into the practical part. Well, the practical or hands-on is going to be the fun, but we need to understand the theoretical concepts as well. If we miss that, we will not be able to grab the complete information. In order to grab the complete information, in order to understand the complete flow of Angular, in the initial stage, yes, we need some theoretical concepts. We need the basics, right? Once the basic is done, then doing practical would be piece of cake. Then doing hands-on will be piece of cake, because by then you actually know that how everything is working behind the scene, right? Well, let's get started then. So we have Angular architecture, where each and every layer of Angular talks to each other on the different situation on the different node as per their call. So we're going to unleash all these layers and see how the entire flow actually happens when we have any call to database, or we post our data to database, or we get the data from the database, right? Well, the very first thing is we will talk about the Angular part, and then we come to database and API layer. So in Angular, whenever we start an Angular project, we always going to have at least one module, right? Now, what is module? Your module is like a package, like a DLL, like a namespace, right? So people who belongs to Java, .NET, they know what is DLL, they know what is namespace. People who are from the front end consider that module is like a package. To understand it, easily, you consider your module, right, like a feature, not functionality, a feature. Now, what a feature can be? Let's see a practical example of feature. So, as I was saying in the last session, this is the social networking site that we're building. Is my screen visible, guys? Are you able to see the screen? Are you able to see the social networking site screen? Social.learnnow.in? Is it clear to you? Is it visible to you? Let me just share it again. So Ram is saying no, I'm not able to see. Let me just share it one more time. Let me know once you're able to see it. You able to see it now? Great. So yeah, so here if you see, if I need to define a module, let's say you have no idea about front end and back end, and you're absolutely a newbie in this business. So how you'll understand in Angular that what is your module? So think of features. Let's say you have admin feature, you have user feature, you have a sub user feature, you have sales feature, you have inventory feature, right? You have user management feature. If you see our social networking site, So you will be having one feature called companies, where you will play with everything and anything related to company. Just an example, you have a feature called project, right? You'll have a feature called profile, you will have a feature called job, you'll have a feature called messages, right? All these things will come under the hood of our social networking site. Apart from that, we'll be having the other things as well for connecting people, like education, health, talent, right? So things like that. So consider all these things are the feature of our project. Now, if someone wants to compare, someone wants to check what is this module in our application. So I would say all these features will be representing, one module. For example, we'll be having one company module, we'll be having one project module, we'll be having one profile module, we'll be having one job module, we'll be having one messages module, right? If you consider notification also, so notification will also be a module. So what I'm trying to say is, your module is nothing but your feature, right? Which holds the complete functionality, which holds all the functionality of your feature, correct? So that is your module. So your application, Angular application, is going to have at least one module. So initially, when you start your project in Angular, you will get one default module called app module. But that doesn't mean that you cannot create your own module. As I showed you, the web application that we are going to build in Angular, social.learner.in, this is the mock-up application which is built in HTML CSS by our UX team. We are going to convert that application into Angular. So when we convert it into Angular, by default we will get one module called app module, and then we are going to add all the modules, like as I showed you, like company, job, you know, all the social tabs like talent, education, health, right? Society tab, where you can connect to each other, right? Where you can say where you can help each other. So whatever features we'll be having in the application, we are going to make a module out of it one by one, step by step. We're going to add, you know, module. So the very first thing, when you add all these modules, you will see your application is having multiple modules. Initially your application will have only one module, right? Okay, so any doubt, any question you have in the module section, guys? Any question, any doubt you have in the module section? No? Mahesh, Murli, Ram, Sai, Komli, Shilpa, okay. So I'm back. Yeah. So that is your module basically, right? I think you know, picture should be clear to you about the module. So module will represent the higher node, I mean the entire feature. Now your feature will be nothing without the functionality, isn't it? So if we talk about any feature, means any module, like we talk about company module, right? So in company module, what we'll be doing? In company module, we'll be basically adding a new company, one functionality, updating, you know, a company information, another functionality, deleting a company, again third functionality, listing down all the companies, again fourth functionality. By clicking on the company, we'll be having a grid of company, clicking on one particular company, and getting the information on the other page will be again one functionality, right? So what I'm trying to explain is, we have already segregated our features into module, done. But every module will have the complete functionality about it. So if it is, let's say, job module, so you will be having all the functionality related to job module. For example, as a given example for company, if you take an example of job also, so job tab or job module or job feature will have function like creating a job, right? Posting a job, right? Deleting a job, listing down all the job, showing all the jobs in the grid. When you click on any of the job in the grid, going to a separate page and giving the complete description about the job, that is also, one functionality. So all these functionality will be represented by a component. So here come a new thing in this Angular architecture called component. What is component? So component is a basic or fundamental unit of programming in Angular. No matter what you do, right, each and every functionality will be represented by a component. When you have a complete functionality, which means you need to have a component. So a component will represent a complete functionality, right, which you are basically doing. So here, in the case of company, in the case of job, let's take an example of job. So in the job, I say creating a job. So creating a job is one component. This is one functionality, so you need to create a component called create job. Then deleting a job, again one component if you want, right? If your application is huge, you can break down the functionality into pieces. Otherwise, if I will be handling the project, what I will do is I will create at least three components. One is creating a job, right? Second is viewing a job, correct? When you click on the grid, when you click on any of the row of the grid, then you will see a next page where complete information about the job is there. So viewing a job where I will have a delete and update functionality, right? So one second component, and third component will be a grid where you will show all the jobs in the list. So I see three components here in this job module, right? So any functionality you have will be represented by a component. Now what component will be having inside it, let's dig deep into it, right? Let's dive deep into it. So your component is a composition of your template and a class, right? So now everyone wonders like how this Angular works superbly, like why everyone is after Angular. There's a strong reason behind it. I've already explained the why part in session one, right? You already have the recording, you can go through with it in the previous session. I've explained why we need Angular. So I'm just giving a brush up of it. Because Angular has TypeScript, because Angular has a concept called TypeScript, Angular has a programming skills, programming tools like programming techniques, like I should say, right technical word, programming techniques like modular approach, component-based approach. So what are module? I already explained you. Creating a different module will segregate the functionality, segregate the feature among, within the application, right? Instead of having one big fat file of all the features, you have a different feature, you have different modules, correct? In every module, you will be having all the functionality in the form of components within that module, which is again, separated from each other, separation of concern and dependency injection, correct? So why component based approach is so cool? The reason is because we have a separate template and we have a separate class file. So we have a template means HTML code and a code behind file. Now this code behind file is is nothing but a class file. Now where this class come into picture? That is where your TypeScript will be in the play. Your Angular is so successful. The major reason of Angular being successful is because TypeScript is included. When you say TypeScript, is it a new scripting language? Answer is yes, it is a new scripting language. But do you need to put any effort to learn it? Answer is no. Why? A very simple reason, because your TypeScript is OOPS based scripting language. Now, what is OOPS? In a simple definition, object-oriented structure, in a very simpler definition, if you wanted to extend the OOPS, you take it like you will be having classes, you will be having objects, which I'm going to show today. Classes, object, list, data members, methods, inheritance, interface, right? Enums, correct? All these things you have whatever you have in the OOPS, you are having it in TypeScript, correct? Which means if you have a 15 years of experience or 10 years of experience in, let's say, C# or Java, right? Or you are just a college graduate who knows C++, both are equal for Angular 7, right? So you don't need to actually learn anything before you come to Angular 7. So if you come completely clean slate, that is also fine. In fact, that is much better, because now if you come as a clean slate, you don't have a baggage of you know, other backend or front end side technology. I mean, server side or client side technologies, right? Because in Angular, if you know OOPS, that is good enough. You will understand everything, because that is the base. Why? Because we have TypeScript. TypeScript. Why TypeScript? Because TypeScript support OOPS. What is OOPS? OOPS means object oriented structure, which means you have classes, right? So now, as I said, an experienced guy in .NET Java and a college graduate, both are equal in Angular. Both can understand Angular equally. Why? Because they know the basic concept of OOPS. They know what is classes. They know what is objects, methods. They know inheritance. So they can very well easily work in Angular. And hence, I wanted to put, you know, focus on this one. Hence, in overnight, once you able to learn basic of Angular in 5-6 sessions. So within 5-6 session or after 5-6 session, you will successfully be able to, you know, call yourself as a UI developer as well. So far you were a DBA guy, right? Database administrator, for example, or a fresher, or a front end guy for that matter, right? Or a back end developer, like .NET Java developer. Now, after learning Angular, correct, in no time, maybe 5-6 sessions of basic Angular will be good enough for you to take any user story. After that, in no time, you will be a UI developer as well. Where if you wanted to learn other, you know, front end libraries like React.js, Vue.js, right, jQuery, Ember.js, Extension.js. I mean, there's so many JS in the market, Knockout.js. You need time to learn. Why? Because there is a separate syntax, because this is a separate concept. You are learning JavaScript library, right? You're learning JavaScript library. So you need to put focus on the JavaScript technique, JavaScript tools like callback, like closure, like promises, right? All these things, whatever you have in the JavaScript, you need to understand, then only you will be able to understand these front-end libraries. But in Angular, you have no burden of learning JavaScript, because you're not learning JavaScript. You're not doing anything in JavaScript. So you don't need to learn JavaScript. Many of the people have this, this confusion that before learning Angular, do I need to upgrade myself into HTML5, CSS3, JavaScript especially, right? Any JavaScript library I need to, you know about, like jQuery. So answer is no. If you're not an expert or intermediate in HTML5, CSS3, it's fine. You should know only the basic of HTML, like all the tags of HTML, like div tag, input tag, form tag, button tag, right? Which you all know already, which you already gone through with it so many times. I mean, in your studies, academics also, you have learned HTML, basic HTML, the basic tags, good enough, right? Basic CSS, if you know, good enough. If you don't know, that is also fine. Angular doesn't say that you have to be in a CSS expert to, you know, before picking me up. So that anyways, you will be learning, within the course. So what exactly is the requirement? What exactly is the prerequisite for picking Angular 7 or before picking Angular 7? So the prerequisite is just OOPS. If you know OOPS, good enough. If you have basic knowledge of OOPS, super, good enough. You don't need anything else, before starting Angular 7, right? Simple reason. Why? Because Angular is not a JavaScript library, or Angular is not a JavaScript framework. Angular uses TypeScript. The whole Angular architecture is written in TypeScript, right? They themselves use classes, interfaces, enums, right? OOPS concept. Getting my point? So learning Angular is far, far, far easier than learning any other front-end library. And still, Angular is a, a client-side framework, right? It's not a server-side. So your code is not going to compile at server-side. Your code is going to compile at browser itself. Now the question is, how your browser does your browser understand TypeScript? Answer is no. Then how come Angular application, can run in the browser? Here come the magic. When you develop your code, see the beauty of Angular architecture. When you develop your code, you're developing your code in TypeScript. Whenever you write a code, you are writing a class, you are writing an interface, you are writing enums, you are writing objects, methods, classes, functions, right? You're doing all this code in OOPs, in classes, in interfaces, as I said, right? Just like server-side scripting language, just like C#, just like C++, just like Java. Hence, life of a programmer is very easy, because now the programmer who let's say a DBA guy or a Java.NET guy or a PHP guy or a front-end guy or a C++ guy, right? Or a college fresh out, for him, it's easy to write a code, right? When you're doing development, you are using TypeScript. But your Angular architecture, what Angular architecture is doing is when you compile your project, when you build your project, that is where the magic happens. Your TypeScript compiler will take all your TypeScript file, all your class file, TypeScript file, and pick all your TypeScript file and convert them into JavaScript. So the end game, the end result, which is supposed to be JavaScript, that is not done by you. That is the beauty of architecture. That is where the learning curve is. That is where the burden of learning JavaScript is cut off. You need to continue the way you have done or the way you have been doing since ages, right? Ever since you started the programming, which means OOPs concept. You are developing your code in OOPs, in classes, interfaces, enums, right? Methods, properties, list, correct? But when you compile your project, when you build your project will turn or will compile, your TypeScript compiler will basically invoke, to be precise, picks all the TypeScript file and convert them into JavaScript. Now you see it's a win-win situation for you and the browser both, because you don't know the JavaScript part, browser don't know the TypeScript part. Hence, what Angular has done is it has offered you the TypeScript so that you can develop your code easily. And it is offering the browser pure JavaScript, HTML and CSS, which browser understand. So once you're done with your programming, once you're done with your development, when you build your project, your TypeScript compiler will invoke. It will take, as I said, it will take all the TS files, convert them into JavaScript, and those JavaScript files only are going to the browser. Hence, you see, you are taking a leverage of all server-side scripting language. Everything you have in server-side scripting language, that all is there in Angular. And at the same time, your code is not getting compiled or run in the server or at the server side. No, your code is getting compiled or run inside your browser. So you have a goodness of client-side scripting also and server-side scripting also. That is why Angular 2+ framework, 2+ framework means Angular 2, Angular 4, Angular 6, Angular 7, Angular 8 is going to come, is so super cool. It's so awesome. That is why, ever since this Angular 2 came, all the companies have migrated or started migrating from Angular 1 to Angular 2. In fact, whoever is having their project in .NET web project, not all the project, web project in .NET and Java or PHP, they have converted it into Angular 2+ framework. Because Angular 2+ framework supports all the server-side scripting feature at client-side, right? So your application is 1,000 times faster. If you see your .NET, Java, PHP application, all these server-side application basically compiles at server-side and then renders back in the form of HTML, JavaScript, CSS and come to browser, which isn't the case in our Angular. Angular application will get compiled in the browser itself, get processed in the browser itself. All the calls are within the browser itself. So it is 1,000 times faster than any server-side application, right? Got my point? So is that part clear, that why angular is so cool, why learning angular is so easy? Because we have TypeScript, right? So now I come back to the question, or come back to the topic from where we started this discussion, which is component. So in the component, the class file is nothing but your TS file. You will be having a TS file. Component, your component is nothing but a TS file. In the component, what you will find is, you'll find one HTML and one class. Now there should not be a question that what is class? Yeah, I guess we have a question. Okay, so Piyush joined. So hi Piyush, I guess you're a little late. So no problem. This is getting recorded, and I am explaining the Angular architecture, right? So so far we covered the modules part and modules part in Angular. What is modules? So as I said in the previous session, that your modules are nothing but your features in your application. Let's say Amazon application. You have seen Amazon application. So, or Paytm application, or Amazon application, or any of the web application you see, you have different tabs, right? So those different tabs, like deals of the day, my wish list, right? So whatever you have features, you consider those features as module. So I have given an example here itself, like admin module. So you will be having a different modules, different features, like admin feature, like user feature, right? Correct? In application like LinkedIn, you have company feature, you have job feature, right? Okay. In Facebook application, you have again group feature, creating a page feature, group feature, correct? So all these features will be represented by a module. So in your Angular application, you will be having at least one default module, that is by default app.module. And after that, you can basically add your own module, correct? Whenever you see a new feature. So, correct? Is that clear, Piyush?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So now I was just before you joined, I was talking about the component. So every feature will have n number of functionality, right? If you talk about LinkedIn application, you have companies and job. So company feature will have lot of functionality, like creating a company, list of the company, view the company detail. In the job feature, creating a new job, checking a list of all the jobs, clicking on the job and viewing the complete information about the job. So all these things are the functionality basically, right? So in Angular, basically, as I said, we'll be having multiple modules. Every module will be having some functionality. Each and every functionality represented by a component. Why? Because component is a basic fundamental unit of programming. Why? There's a reason. That is what I was explaining before you joined. Because your component is having a template as well as a class file. Template as well as a class file. Right? So template is nothing but HTML, and class file is nothing but your TS file, TypeScript file. That is what I was explaining before you join, that what is TypeScript file? Your whole Angular architecture is built in TypeScript. Angular 2 Plus framework is not a JavaScript framework. It is a TypeScript framework. TypeScript is a product of Microsoft. Nobody was giving a real importance to TypeScript before Angular, took it. So you won't even believe that after Angular 1 version, when Angular 1 was successful, Microsoft has launched TypeScript long back. So you can say TypeScript is also there in the market since very long. But it came into fashion when Google started developing Angular 2 in TypeScript. Correct? So TypeScript basically supports your it is a scripting language, but it is different from the JavaScript. It supports OOPS concept. So in JavaScript you will see only functions or only objects, but in TypeScript what you will see is classes, interfaces, enums, method inside the class, list inside the class, array inside the class. variables inside the class, data members inside the class, in short. So the way you are doing a programming in your C#, Java, PHP, right? The class-based programming, OOPS-based programming, the same programming you're going to do in the TypeScript. So that is the beauty of TypeScript. That is the beauty of Angular itself. Now, what I was explaining, that you as a developer will code, will develop your code in TypeScript. So you have no burden to learn TypeScript, because as I said, TypeScript will be having the similar kind of syntax what you have in your C#, Java, PHP, or C++ for that matter. Which means your college graduate and your experienced guy in .NET Java is same, because both of them knows OOPS concept. Both of them knows what is class. So learning wise, you'll not find anything new or challenging in TypeScript. You will see, okay, it's the same syntax, it's the same way I'm typing, I'm doing a code in my C#, Java, PHP, or C++, right? But once you're done with your development, because your browser doesn't understand your TypeScript. So once you're done with the development, when you build your project, your TypeScript compiler will take all your TS files, correct, and convert them into JavaScript. So that is what I was explaining, that your browser and you have win-win situation. You don't know the JavaScript, or you don't want to learn the JavaScript, right? So you work in TypeScript, because that is what you will understand very easily, because this is OOPS based. TypeScript is OOPS based, object oriented programming structure based, class interfaces. And your browser doesn't understand the TypeScript. Your browser only understands JavaScript, HTML, CSS, or XML. So what Angular has done is, Angular says you develop your code in TypeScript. And what I will do is, I will convert your TypeScript code into JavaScript, which your browser will understand. So now that is what with the help of this TypeScript, the learning curve of a new framework or a new technology is reduced. That is why all the companies, the whole market is after Angular 2+ framework, because it's easy to learn. It is easy to implement. You can overnight turn your backend developers into UI developers. Correct? There is no boot camp or a long sessions for learning a new JavaScript framework. Within three days, which means 24 hours, right, of session of Angular, can make you a complete UI developer out of the backend developer. Right? It is that easy. So coming back to the component, so what you will find in component, why component is a fundamental unit of programming? Because your component has HTML and the class file. Now, what HTML will do and what class file will do, let's see. So let's take a simple example. What if you are getting a data from the database, right? You're getting, let's say, the employee information. You're getting the employee information from the database. Now, where are you going to get the employee information? Question one. Question two, how are you going to print it on the HTML? Correct? I mean, it's pretty much the same flow what we do in any of the application, in any of the web project, irrespective to technology, either it is Java-based web project or .NET-based web project or simple HTML-based web project or PHP-based web project, right? That is what we do, get the data from the database and show it on the HTML. Is that correct, guys? Yes or no? Mm-hmm. Correct? Correct? So how we're going to do that? So what happens is, the data, I'm not explaining the injector, API layer, and DB as of now. I'll go step by step. So consider that you already have the data from the DB. How? We'll talk about later. You have the data, you have employee detail. Now you wanted to print that employee detail on HTML. So you will receive the data in your class file. So this component, right, where they have written component, actually this will be a class file. Because your component will have at least two things. One is your HTML and one is your class file, right? So you will receive the data from the DB in your class file. Let's say you got the employee information. Now what you'll do is, just like in your C#, Java, PHP, C++, you will create the properties. You'll create an object. Object will have property. Let's say employee object you created. You'll populate the employee object, right, with the data which you get from the DB. And those properties will be available right? Those properties, you will inject it in the HTML. This process is called property binding. You can see this one. This process is called property binding. Let me just pick the highlighter. Give me a second. Yeah. So this step, correct? From component, you're passing your object or properties. From component, you're passing it to HTML. You're injecting it into the HTML. That is what is called property binding. So now with the help of property binding, you can pretty much show anything on the HTML, whatever you get from the database, or if you hard coded it. Is that clear? Are we good? Right? For example, you have take another example for reference. You have employees information. You have a lot of employees or students or teachers or courses, or let's say your emails, right? You open Gmail and you see so many mails, right? So let's take an example of Gmail. The moment you open and you got some, 100 mails. So how are you going to print this data? So once you receive it in the class, you will create an array. You will populate an array of let's say my mail array. You'll populate that array and then you bind that array in the HTML, or you can inject, you inject that array into the HTML, which we call template or view, right? And hence template will be showing all the information, all the mails to you. That is what we call property binding. Is that part clear, guys? Are you clear with this? Trust me, if you understood the architectural diagram, learning Angular will be a piece of cake, because then you have a clarity that where I need to code, what I need to code. Is property binding clear to all of you? Murli, Piyush, Mahesh, yeah, Ram, Shilpa, how about you, Komali? Sai? Okay. So I got a chat also. You can put it in the chat just like others. Murli, Piyush, you can put it in the chat also. Put your comment in the chat also. If you have a question to ask, yes, unmute yourself. Please go ahead and ask your question. Okay. So that's the beauty of live session. Live session means everything is live. Whatever errors you see live, what is the resolution of error, I mean how you rectify the error, that is also live. We are interacting also live. You ask your question is also live. I answer them also live. Everything is getting recorded, right? Okay, now you see case 2 is from HTML to your class. I mean, best example is login. You have a login form, which means you have a login HTML where you have a username and password with a button. Obviously, whatever username and password has been put up in those text boxes, on the click of submit button, it has to go to DB. The end game is the final result should be, whenever I click on submit, this login credentials, I mean this username and password, has to go to DB, so that it can check against the table, login table. That's the end story. But how we actually do it, right, in Angular? So you have a form, as I said, you have a HTML, as I said, you have text boxes, you populate the text boxes with username, let's say ajay@gmail.com, password ajay@123. The moment you submit, now your form data has to go to DB, as I said. So what will happen now is you need to introduce event binding. You will be having a click event here on the button. So the moment you click the button, your button will post that data to your component, to your class, sorry. Right? So in the class, you will be having a method called let's say login handler, for example, a user defined method, correct? Login handler. And in the login handler, you will receive the data from the form. That is what we call event handler, event binding. So you will be binding a click event in the HTML, correct? And on that event binding, you are posting a data from HTML to your class. That is what we call event binding. So here you need a click event. Similarly, for example, on hover, you wanted to do some functionality. So that would be a hover event. Let's say on on Blur, when you come out of the text box, you wanted to do some programming. Let's say you wanted to change the background of the text box because you came out of the text box. So you will see you will have to have an event called mouse out, right? Or mouse leave. When you wanted to go into the text box and wanted to change the background color of the text box, like focus, usually we see this focus effect in the form. So you will apply mouse enter event. So what I'm trying to say is, for any kind of functionality that you bring on the HTML page, right, is called event binding. Any event you add to the HTML page is called event binding. And with the help of event binding, you will be able to post the data from your HTML page to your class file, right? This is what we call event binding. Is this much part clear, guys? Are we good on this? All clear? Great. Okay. Now we need to see from where we are getting the data into the component, into the class, component class, from where we are getting the data, or how, not where, we know where, how we are getting the data in the component class, right? And how the component class is posting the data to DB, right? How we are getting the data from the DB in the component class with help of, how we are getting the data from DB in component class, and then we are basically, with the help of property binding, we are showing it on the template. Second, and how, when HTML is posting back the data to my class, how from the class we are passing it to the database, right? That is the next step that we're going to see. Okay, as I said, I'm taking step by step, one by one. So let's see the next step. Okay, so just again, I guess I have a question. Let me just check. Okay, so I've been requested by the team. Let's take a break. Okay. How about taking a break after explaining, you know, this architecture diagram? Then we take a break, right? So after explaining the complete architectural diagram, I will basically take a break, right? Okay. So now we have something called injector in between, right? We call it service also. Very cool feature of Angular. What service says is, let's focus on this one. What service says is, component class should not handle any business logic, any view model creation, any kind of data manipulation, any kind of so hi Jay. So your injector, right? Your service class, right? Your injector basically says, it's a very cool feature, as I said. This says your component class must not handle any kind of UI business logic or any kind of business logic, any kind of data manipulation, correct? All business logic, all data manipulation should be pushed to service. So your service, which we call injectable or injector, right, should handle all your UI business logic, all your data manipulation, correct? Let's say you're getting the data, you're getting the huge data from the database. You're getting, let's say, 100 records, and those 100 records contain, you know, let's say 10 properties. But your view, your HTML required only 5 properties, correct? So where are you going to do this UI logic? Your service will handle this UI logic. It'll make sure that it will create a new array, correct, out of the existing data result which it got by the database. From the database, you are getting 10 properties, right? 100 records, each and every record contain 10 property. But your view doesn't want 10 property. Your view only want 4 properties, correct? So it's your service which will read from each and every node, create a new array, right, with only 4 properties, 100 records, but only 4 properties. And that array, your service is going to return to your component class. So that is how you are getting the data in the component class. Correct? Your component is not at all directly connected to your API or your DB. I still need to explain this API and DB. But if you see the flow, your component class has no connection, correct, to your API layer or to your DB. It's your service basically which is going to feed your component class. Always remember, your service is going to feed your component class. Now the question is, from where service will get the data, right? Because service also cannot manufacture the data. Or if service will manufacture the data, it will be hard-coded data. Your service also need to get data from somewhere. That somewhere is database. So now the question is your service directly connected to DB? Answer is no. Your service is also not directly connected to DB. Now I'm showing you the second usage of this service, which is, you can see at the bottom I've written, your service, first usage of services, it contains all your UI business logic, which I've just now explained you. You got 10 properties from the database and you wanted to show only 4. So in the service, you will write a function which will create a new array with only 4 properties. That is a UI business logic. That's the first usage of service. Second usage of service is to get that data, service has to set up asynchronous HTTP call to your APIs. Right, your APIs which are available in the market, right? There are so many APIs. The whole market, the whole IT world is based on service. In fact, not IT. In fact, your real time world also is filled with API. I'm going to give an example of good APIs, good examples of APIs after this topic. Let me just finish the service part first. So your service is going to set up, so second usage of services, it's going to set up an asynchronous call like HTTP GET. Put HTTP calls, asynchronous HTTP calls like GET, PUT, POST, DELETE, right, to your API. So let's say HTTP GET call in the API, HTTP GET call in your service, right, is going to give the data from the DB to my service, correct? So let's say I have a service which wanted to get all the employees. So I will be setting up with the help of HTTP client in Angular 7, I will be using HTTP GET call. I will be using HTTP GET method, right? And pass the URL of the API, correct? And then API will give me the data. Give me the data in the service. Now my service will think, like, do I need to give this data as it is to component class, or I need to create a separate view model, which I explained you previously, that you're getting 10 properties. Now you take this example again. You set up an asynchronous HTTP call. You set up HTTP call to your employee API and get all the employees. All the employees, you got 100 records and it is giving you 10 properties. Each and every record is having 10 properties. But you don't want to show the same on the view, on the HTML. So now the second usage of service will come into picture. You will create a new array out of that response which you get from the API, eventually from the DB. You'll create a new array with only 4 properties, right? And now the new array you're going to pass to your component class. That is why I said your component class will get the feed from your service, will get the data from your service. Now that's a separate topic where your service is getting the data. Is your service manufacturing the data by its own? Is it a hard-coded data, or your service is hitting the API to fetch the data, right? Now we jump on the next part called API layer. Guys, at service, our Angular layer basically raises hands and say, this is what I can do. Point is, after service, your Angular scope is done, finish. Your web project scope is done. Your web project will have this much only. Your web project will have components, you know, services, directive, pipe, these things only, modules, right? Not more than that. This is the left-hand side part is your Angular part, which means your web project part. Then from your web project, which is of course built in Angular, right? Now you are hitting the API project or API layer. The API layer and API project in your solution can be built in any of the technology. It can be a PHP based API. It can be .NET based API, like it can be WCF, it can be web service, it can be web API, right? What else? It can be Java based API, which we use to build in Spring Boot, if I'm not wrong, correct? So API can be, it can be Node.js API, Express.js, which we are going to learn in the project, in this course, correct? So the API project or the API layer can be built in any technology, can be in any form, right? Correct? Can belongs to any of the technology. Angular doesn't care about it. Why? Because when you say API means REST, which you will be connecting over HTTP protocol, which means from the Angular, I just need to set up an asynchronous call over HTTP protocol and hit the API, get the data. Correct? If it is any technology base, any specific protocol base, then I need to think. But API always exposes itself over HTTPS protocol or HTTP protocol, right? Which is open to all, which is available on all the devices. Like you open mobile also, you can work on HTTPS protocol, desktop, any device, any machine, right? Which has internet can consume the API. Now, people who don't know about the API, let me just give a brief introduction about the API. And trust me, your whole life, I mean, whatever technical word you know, that is filled with API. You take your mobile, you open your bank app, you basically, log into it, you check your account, you do fund transfer. API is there, which is doing all these things. The same fund transfer, the same amount checking, if you open your bank application website, you are using the same API. It is API which is doing the fund transfer for you, which is showing your balance to you, correct? You step into a bank, right, and take a token and go to the bank representative, right, and say I wanted to check my account, I wanted to transfer the fund, right, to some other account. That guy also will use the same API. So now you see, the same API, correct, is serving your mobile app. The same API is serving your web application. The same API is being used even in your bank also, correct? If you go to ATM, correct, and try to check your balance, your ATM machine is also using the same API, correct? So that is what API is, application programming interface. Do we have a question? Okay, great. Another example of API is, you see any travel sites, right? Any travel sites. So, I just wanted to highlight that why this API part is so important, right? Why this API part is so cool. So imagine you have, okay, let's take this example in this way. Let's say you and me, let's say we all wanted to make a web application or mobile app, which will show all the flight details, right? All the flight details. So point is, we are the new guys. We are not established yet, right? Will all these aviation companies are going to expose their DB to us? Because the only way of getting the flight detail is to hit their DB. Am I right? The only way to get the flight details of all these, aviation company like Emirates, right? Like British Airways, like Lufthansa, like Go Air, like Indigo, like Indian Airways, right? So all these flight companies or aviation companies, right, have their flight details. So the only way of getting the flight detail is, and the cost of it as well, is to hit their DB. So my question is, will they allow us to hit their DB, and should they allow us to hit their DB? The answer is no, because if they expose their DB to us, right, we can do anything. We are not at all established company. Even with the established company also, why someone will expose their DB to you, right? Isn't it? Even if there's an established company like Infosys or Microsoft also, why they will expose the database to Microsoft even, right? Answer is no, they will not expose the database to them. So what they do is, here come this beautiful concept of encapsulation and abstraction, which is almost everywhere in the world. Take real-time example or take technical example. This OOPS or this abstraction encapsulation, which is a very beautiful option, feature of OOPS, is everywhere. So what they will do is, first of all, they will create an API, correct? Maybe in .NET, maybe in Java, maybe in PHP, maybe in Node, right? They will create an API, which will only give the flight detail, or the API will be connected to DB and will be fetching only the flight detail and its cost. That's it, nothing else. So on this note, what they have achieved is, they have achieved encapsulation as well as abstraction. So how encapsulation? They have encapsulated the whole database, right? The whole information, and they have abstracted only and only flight information with their cost. Flight detail with their cost, right? So they're abstracting the flight detail and its cost only through API. So with the help of API, they have encapsulated and abstracted. They put encapsulation and abstraction. Now these aviation companies or flight companies can expose their APIs to us. So if I wanted to make a site, if we wanted to make a site which will show British Airways flight details, good. I can talk to those guys. We can talk to those guys. Those British Airways people will give us the API and say, this is the API which will give you all the flight detail and its cost. So I can basically consume that API, right? The same way I have an Angular web project. In there, I will be obviously having one component, one module at least one module, at least one component, right? At least one service. In the service, I will be hitting their API link over HTTP GET, right? I'll say HTTP client.get. I'll pass the API URL. What the endpoint, we call it endpoint, the endpoint which British Airways has given it to me. And when I hit it, the data will come in the JSON format. I can consume the data. The point is like this, I can talk to each and every, aviation company and get all the APIs. Now, again, one twist. I have 10 aviation company, which means, do I need to call all 10 one by one? Answer is yes, I can, but there is other way as well. There's always a middleman in the middle. There's always a middleware in between. So you can say there are companies. What they do is there are companies called service provider, which call themselves as service provider, right? So there are companies called service provider. What they do is they consume all the APIs and release one single API. See the beauty of APIs, right? I want you to understand this API concept, because the whole world is full with API. I mean, maybe tomorrow you will listen, API word at least thrice or four times in your day-to-day activity, right? It is that, it is growing that big. So there will be a service provider. Correct. Let's say Airtel is a service provider, right? So there will be a service provider called Airtel. What it will do is it will consume all those 10, 20, I mean, whatever number of aviation companies we have. It will listen or consume all those 10, 20 APIs of respective aviation companies. All those APIs, it will consume all those APIs and collaborate the data and release one single API. So now we will be consuming that one single API, correct? We'll be paying for that service, for the API, and we'll be basically consuming that one single API. And now life will be easy for us, because now we don't need to take care about the 10 APIs or 20 APIs of different aviation company. Now it's one single API, which I need to integrate in my project, and my life is done, easy, right? So that is API. Correct. Not only that, one more cool example of API is, if there is a legacy application, think in this way, and it's a very good architectural solution. If there is a very old application, legacy application, which is built in very old technology. Now you want to boot it up and wanted to make it a web application, or at least you want some reporting on web application. Let's assume there's a console-based application, a C++ kind of project, a console application project, which is running only on single machine. But you are sitting, you know, in a different geographical location where you wanted to consume the data. You wanted to get a report. What is happening on in my factory? What is happening at my site, right? Correct? What is the data I'm having in my local database? I mean, the database which is there in that system itself, correct? Which is not there in the internet, which is not at all a web application. So what you can do is you can introduce this API layer, and this API will read from the database and expose the data to you. And now you can make a simple Angular application, simple one or two page Angular application, a web application, which will consume that API, and that API is getting the data from the database. So now you see, without touching your existing legacy application, without changing the code or build of the existing legacy application, how you can enhance that application, and in no time you can make a web application out of it. That's the beauty of Angular and Web API. Is it clear, guys? Is it good enough? I mean, API and Angular. So now if you get the maintenance project also, right, which says our application is so old, it is a legacy application, we don't want to touch it, right? Tell us the solution. So this is the solution. You introduce API, you introduce Angular, right? And your life is sorted. Now let that legacy application do whatever it wants, right? On the daily basis, you can have the sync up. You will get the report. I mean, what is happening in my DB? You will get the detail at every interval, right? What do you say, guys? Isn't it cool? The combination of API and Angular? Yes or no? All good? Okay. So, okay, we have a question, I guess. Great. So all good, right? Ram has a question. Let me just check. How API will be connected to database? Okay. Yes, that is what I'm going to explain next time. So how API is going to, you know, talk to DB? That's basically, if this is only Angular course, then I mean, I need not to take care of this question. But yes, this is a full stack development. Then you should know how API is going to talk to database. Now point is, it depends upon what database you have taken. Right, and what is the technology of your API? Let's say if it is a .NET based API, so I can use Entity Framework, right? My Entity Framework will talk to my database and post the data and get the data, right? I mean, to and fro happen with the DB, and my API can manage it. If it is Java, so your API will be in Spring Boot, if I'm not wrong. I'm not a Java guy, but that is what I know. With the help of Spring Boot, we can make, you know, web APIs, right? APIs. So in Java, again, you will write your API, and you will be having, you will definitely be having a database driver, either ODBC or ODBC ODBC or Oracle DB, right? You will be having a database driver. With the help of database driver, you will be having a CRUD operation, correct, with your Oracle database, correct? If it is PHP, so if your API is in PHP, then you will be using MySQL database. So again, you will be having ODBC driver. ODBC driver will give you access to all the database operation, right, which you're going to perform on MySQL. Got my point, guys? If your API is in Express, which we are going to have in our project, if your API will be in Express.js layer, which is Node.js, right? If your API is in Node.js, then your database will be MongoDB, which we'll be using in this course, MongoDB. So your Node.js or Express.js will have Mongo client, MongoDB client, which is nothing, which is as good as your database driver, right? MongoDB client. With the help of MongoDB client, it will be able to hit the MongoDB. Right? Does it answer your question, Ram? Good. So is it clear to all of you guys? Are we good? All set? Great. So this is the end of the theoretical part, right? You might be wondering, what is this directive? What are the pipes? I will love to pick the directives or pipes in the practical session. I mean, that there you will get the right and clear picture that why we use directive, why we use pipes, what are these things, right? It'll be very handy. It'll be very easy for you to understand when I show you the live of it, right? And there only I am going to throw the theory also in front of you. Okay. One more thing, Sai has a question that what is this metadata? In fact, the metadata also I wanted to show you, because the simple definition of metadata is data about the data. But what about data about the data? What is data about the data? Again, when I show you the practical part, I would like to take this theory, right? This concept, theoretical concept, in the with the practical, right? That will actually make sense, and you will, in split of second, you will understand, okay, this is metadata, or this is directive, right? Or this is pipe, correct? So far, this is the architecture of Angular, plus outside the Angular as well. I have basically shown you the Angular architecture also, and Angular based application architecture as well. This is how it works. If you don't have any question, then I would love to start the practical. I would love to start the hands-on, right? Of course, after the break, so many people are asking for a break. So let's take a quick break of 10 minutes, right? If you have any question, I will answer it now and then go for a break. If you don't have a question, then let me take a break, and after the break, we'll start the hands-on on Angular. Exactly how we work in Angular. So far in previous session and this session, what we have seen is, what is Angular? Why we need to use Angular? We are already, we've been working already in our .NET, Java, PHP, front-end based application, React, Knockout, anything. We've already been working successfully. Angular 1 also for that matter. Why all of a sudden there is a need to create application or to transform the application from the other front-end libraries or back-end technologies to Angular plus, Angular 2 plus framework, Angular 6, Angular 7, Angular 4, right? Why? That also explained. Now there is a time to see how exactly we work. What is module? How we add module? How we work with module? How we work with component? How to add component? How to add directive? How to create services? Right? How to use pipes, filters. So all these things we're going to see in the hands-on session. So guys, any question before we go for a break? Any doubt, any question you have? No? Okay. So let me take a break. We're taking a break of 10 minutes and then we start the hands-on part, right? So I'm freezing my screen and putting myself on mute. In sharp 10 minutes, we'll resume the session. Okay. Hi team, I'm back. So recording has been started. So now what we need to check is how we're going to set up our Angular, right? Angular framework in our system, right? So that we can create projects out of Angular, so that we can create new application out of Angular. Correct? So we need to install basically Angular CLI framework. Command line interface. CLI means command line interface, which means you're going to interact to a framework with the help of commands. Correct? Commands, a lot of commands. So what is the way to set it up? Let's check this one. So what you're supposed to do is, give me a minute. Just 1 minute. One sec, guys. Okay. So to set up your Angular, right, you first of all, you have to have a Node.js, right? So what is Node.js? Let me just explain. So you need to go to Node.js.org, right? So basically Node.js is a tool which is built in JavaScript, right? And it's a very strong, you know, JavaScript engine. When I say strong means, you know, what it does, you can create your entire server into Node.js. It is as good as Tomcat Apache IIS server. The way you have IIS server, the way you have Tomcat Apache server, on the similar node, you can create your entire server in your Node.js. You can write your load balancer in Node.js. So Node.js is something which we cannot finish in a day or you know, sessions. It itself is a huge technology. But do we need to take the entire Node.js for Angular? Answer is no. We need only a small portion of Node.js, you know, in Angular. We need basically Node.js for two things. One, give us the local development server so that we can host our Angular project to Node.js and we can check all the you know, server features, correct? Second thing, we need a package manager because we are totally front end, right? So we need a package manager which will download packages. When I say packages, means libraries. I mean, open source libraries, open source modules, open source packages, all are one of the same thing. Don't get confused. When somebody says package, library, modules, all are same. So to download and install these open source packages, libraries, like modules, we need some package manager. So that is why we need Node. So Node has, as I said, two tasks. One, Node, I need Node as a package manager. Two, I need Node as a local development server, right? Or Angular needs basically a Node to behave like a local development server so that Angular can host its application to Node. So the prerequisite for even, you know, much before starting with Angular is you should have Node installed in your system. So I have already installed my system. So, you know, what you're supposed to do is I cannot show you how to install it. And that is also not a big deal. So point is, you just need to say next, and done. There is no pre-setting for Node. Don't even worry about it, that which checkbox I need to click, what radio button I need to click. You don't need to click anything. You simply say next, and in 3 to 4, you know, clicks, your Node will install. There is no pre-setting for Node. Don't worry about it. So what is the version, you know, is suggested for the Node is always the recommended version, because latest version may not go with your Angular version, right? So we always should go with the recommended version. Why recommended? Because it is tested with all the you know, packages, right? Will all the frameworks, libraries, which is there, you know, in Node repository. So always should use a recommended version. So the moment you click on download for Windows, click, and this will basically give you a MSI file which you need to install. Now, next question is, do we have only for Windows? Can't we have it for Mac system or, you know, any other you know, OS? So answer is yes, we do have. If you go to downloads, if you go to downloads, you have Node.js for all kind of OS. Any open source, if you have Mac OS, you have Windows, you have, right? So you have basically for all. And the recommended one only you need to install. Don't go with the later with the current one, right? Once you install Node, right, then you should go with the Angular installation. So what you're supposed to do for the Angular installation is, this is the command. I will share all these things in a shared location, right? And that location I will share with you. I'll put it on some Git, Google Drive, right? This recording of today's session will also be there in YouTube, right? And either there I will add all these steps, or I will make a location, separate location in Google Drive and host all these things over there, right? In all the cases, you will get notified. Don't worry about it. Okay, Now, after your Node.js installation, what is the next step that you need to do? Next step is, yes, which we are eagerly waiting for. That is how to install your Angular, right, at the global level in your system. So this is the command. So when you say, just 1 minute, copy. I will open one command prompt, right? We don't need to check for any folder because you are installing it globally. So you can simply type this command. So npm, always remember Node Package Manager, because you have installed Node. And by the way, how you'll get to know that Node is installed? So in the start window, you can say Node, right? And if you find node.js, which means Node is installed in your system, correct? Okay. What is the next thing? Next thing is, as I said, the command npm Node Package Manager, because I have installed the Node, that is why I will be able to use this command npm Node Package Manager. So I'm telling basically Node that, hey, Node, npm Node Package Manager, install minus G is a switch. Install is a command to install. Install what? Install Bootstrap, jQuery, AngularJS, ReactJS, Vue.js, right? Knockout, extension, Chai, Mocha, Protector, Karma, Jasmine. I mean, what exactly you wanted to install? So you need to give your basically framework or library. What exactly you want to package? What exactly you wanted to install? So I say @ Angular/CLI. I want to install Angular/CLI framework. Right? That is a command to install Angular/CLI. So Angular/CLI. CLI means command line interface, because you will be interacting with the Angular framework with commands. That is why it is called Angular CLI. And minus G is a switch. So if you say minus G, what will happen is this will install the framework globally on the shared location. What is a global location? C drive, users, let's say Ajay Shankar is my user, then data, app data, roaming. Inside that, you will find that it will install all the global packages. So if I install Angular CLI globally, so it will be installed globally at the shared location in my system, right? If I don't use minus G switch, then it will install Angular CLI locally. Locally means in my project itself, not globally for my machine, for my system, locally in my project itself. I guess we have a question. Let me just take it. Jay, in Mac, you check, do you have C drive? I'm not sure about the Mac, but in the Mac also. Okay, when you will be installing, good point. When you will be installing, Jay, when you will be installing it, that time you can basically check where it is installing. When you hit this command, it will give you where it is installing it globally, right? So Akash join, Winstry join. Hi guys. You join in the second part, or rather join at the very right time, because we are starting how you miss what is Angular, why we should use Angular. That you will get it in my previous session recording and this session recording in the start, first half also. But now we are starting how we are actually going to work with Angular, how exactly we'll work with Angular. So far I have covered only that, what is the command to install Node.js, and how to install Angular. So Jay saying, where does it keep in the Mac? And then, okay. Before npm, you need to type sudo. Before npm, you need to type sudo, sudo in MacBook. So sudo npm install minus g. So for Mac, for any npm command, before npm command, we will write sudo, sudo, right? And don't worry, Jay, I will assist you in installing it. But as of now, just focus what I am doing, because this is getting recorded, and later you can go through with the video and you can practice at the same time. Don't worry, I will assist you. Don't worry about it. Okay. So what we are doing now is we are checking how we will work in Angular. So these are the steps before working with Angular. You need to install Node.js, right? That is what I've showed Akash and Vincent. So you go to Node.js.org, click on download option. click on downloads option. And there, whatever is your OS, as per your OS, what you do is you install it. Install the recommended version, right? Once you download it, you just need to say next, 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 and done. You don't need to go through with any of the setting. There's no pre-setting. There's no fixed setting for Node. Just say next, 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 and done. Once your Node is installed, once your Node is done, that is where you, that is when you need to, you know, step ahead and you need to install the Angular CLI. So once the Node is done, which means Node is installed in your system, which means you can write, you can use npm commands, Node Package Manager. Why we need node, as I explained earlier, that we need Node for two things. One, to have a local development server. Angular use Node as a local development server. And second thing, we use Node for package management. Because we are working with open source technologies, Angular framework is an open source framework. We need lot of packages to be installed, download and install in our project. So we cannot go ahead to each and every site and download it. Let's see Node in this way. That your, I always used to give this example. Your Node is like a pharmacist, like pharmacy guy or a chemist or pharmacy guy, right? I mean, pharmacy guy is much easier to understand in western part of the world. In eastern part of the world, we call it chemist, right? A person who gives medicines. So consider your Node like a pharmacy guy, like a chemist, right? Which has all the medicines in its repository. Now, you will come to Node and say, I need these medicines, which means I need these many packages. Node will read all the packages, and one by one it will install all the packages, it will download all the packages in your project, right? Or in your system. Correct? So Node has a repository of almost all open source packages. It's the biggest library of open source packages, right? So now, as we are waiting for the Angular installation, so npm is a Node package manager command. So we are saying npm or sudo npm in case of Mac. We're saying Node install is a command, minus g is a switch, install it globally, not locally. If I remove the minus g switch, then it will install Angular CLI in this path only, within the folder, within system.32, right? Or whichever folder I give, it is going to install there only if I miss minus g switch. But when I say minus g, means what I'm saying is npm install Angular CLS, Angular, slash CLI minus G, which means I'm installing Angular CLI framework globally. So there's a global location. I can show you the global location also for Windows. So you can go to C drive. You will find the users. In the users, you will have my user, Ajay Shankar, right? Same thing will be for you. Then app data, then roaming, and then we have npm, if I'm not wrong. Yeah, see here. So here it will install all the packages, right? All the packages globally. Got a point? See, ng for Angular, ng stand for Angular. So all the packages, global packages, will be installed or will be downloaded at this folder when you say globally. So, and yes, we need Angular globally so that we can create multiple projects in Angular. Okay. So it must be installed, globally always. So I have already installed Angular CLI, right? So I don't need to hit this command. When you hit this command, it will take around 2 minutes to install. Again, here also, there's no question asked. Just hit this command and, wait for the, cursor to come back. Once cursor will come back, it will tell you the message. It will show you the message that this version of Angular has been installed in your system, right? The latest version it is going to install, which is Angular 7 plus some odd minor change, right? Odd minor version. So the major version is Angular as of now. Okay, now consider Angular is also installed. Now what? After this, now you create a project. Now you create a repository or a folder where you wanted to create an Angular project, right? So I have already created one for you. So let me just go back to that repository. So I say cd practice project. That's my folder. Inside that you will find training, if I'm not wrong. Yes, inside that you will find this batch. Sorry, inside that you will find Angular folder, right? Inside that you will have batch 60th. No, yeah, full stack batch 63, which is this, which is going to start from 29th of this month, right? Officially the live project, the workshop in short, we are starting from 29th. So full stack batch 63. So this is, let's say, my repository. This is my folder where I'm going to add all the Angular projects, right? I can have one project, I can have 10 projects, I can have 100 projects inside this folder. So I reached till this folder. Now, how to create a new project? Very simple. You have a command called ng. So now Angular is installed. So now I will be talking to Angular. Angular in turn will be talking to Node, right? So I am talking to Angular. So to talk to Angular, I have a command called ng. So ng means Angular. So I'm saying, hey, Angular, new means create new project, right? Followed by the project name. Let's say my basic A7, right? That is my project name, correct? So ng new my basic A7. So Angular create new project followed by the project name, enter. So now my Angular CLI framework will create a new project. You will see, you know, some questions it's going to ask. So although I have, because this process takes time, at least 10 to 15 minutes, depends upon your internet speed, depends upon you're using your personal laptop or company laptop, because a lot of firewalls will get checked, right? So I've already created a separate project, right? But in this, I wanted to show you the process. That is why I am creating a new project, right? So after showing all these steps, I will jump back to the project which I've already created just by following this command, right? So the first question to ask is, do you want Angular routing, right? Routing is an advanced concept of Angular, where we maintain single page application with the help of routing. So obviously, as of now, you know nothing about the routing. So I say, no, I don't need it. If at all, whenever we need it, we will add it. So no. Then it says, very good question. Then it says, which kind of CSS framework or CSS structure you want? That's a right technical word. CSS structure you want. You want the plain vanilla CSS stuff, or you want any preprocessor? Now, what is preprocessor? So preprocessors means one step before the original. You might have seen the prequels, right? Hollywood movies, prequels, correct? You always see first they release, part two, and then they come up how it got started, right? Prequel. So you take this one like a prequel. So preprocessor, which means first of all, why we need the prequel? Why we need the preprocessor? Because in CSS, you cannot do programming. In CSS, you cannot do if else block. You cannot have control statement in CSS, which means you cannot have programming in CSS. You cannot have import option in CSS. You cannot create variables in CSS. You cannot do board mass in CSS. You cannot do plus, minus, divide, multiply in CSS, right? You cannot have control statement in CSS, correct? And in this programming word, yes, we do need programming also in CSS. So if you have such complex structure, which always we are going to have in current era, because there is a lot of demand from CSS side, so we use any of the preprocessor so that we can use import, we can use inheritance, we can use programming, right, in CSS as well. So you can choose any of the preprocessors, CESS, SASS, or LESS. So all are McDonald's and Burger King, right? Both gives the burger, right? But it's just two different companies. So all three are basically preprocessors only. So CESS is little stronger than the rest of the two. Although I worked with the LESS and CESS both, right? So we use basically CESS. So I say yes. Or as of now, if you don't use CESS, I can go with the simple CSS as well. So just enter, right? So you can see this basic project they have created this, they are creating this basic project. The Angular CLI framework is creating this basic project, right? My basic Angular 7 readme, TS config, right? All these files it has created. See all the basic files. I should see basic module, my default module as well. Can you see this one? App module, right? Which I told in the start, you will have in all Angular application, you will have at least one module and at least one component, right? Because module represent a feature and component represent a functionality. Your module will be having n number of functionality and each and every functionality will be represented by a component. Therefore, when they create a new project, they have at least one module and at least one component, right? And then going forward, when you grow old in the project, when you start your project, add, you know, feature by feature, which means you will add more modules and every modules will have more functionality, which means you will add more components, right? So component is your fundamental unit of programming. Whenever you have any functionality, you will create a component for it. Very simple. So now what it is doing, why it is not giving us the cursor back, right? What exactly they're doing, right? Just 1 second. Give me a minute, guys. Just 1 minute. Okay, so I'm back. So what exactly is doing? It is basically downloading, as of now, it is talking to my Angular is talking to my node. And what my node is doing is, my node is basically downloading all the required packages, all the required libraries in my project. Do you want to see what are the packages? Let's check. So let's go to, okay, so in C drive, I have practice project. Inside practice project, I have Angular. Trainings. Then I have Angular. Inside Angular, I have this full stack batch 63, right, which is going to start, as I said, from 29th of June. And then I have this Learn Now Web. Sorry, I have this My Basic Angular 7, which I've created just now, right? So if you go inside that, you will see all the default structures there, but node modules is not there. Node modules will be a folder like bin. People who have already worked with .NET, Java, right? They know what is bin folder. I'm not sure about the PHP, right? Frontend guys also know that there is a folder where all the libraries are there, right? So understanding what is node module folder is not a big deal. Node module folder, which it is creating, as of now it is not created. You can see it is still, you know, going on. The process is still going on. So once the process, that's why I already created a project for you, because this process takes time. So Angular is talking to node. Node is checking my firewalls, right? The security is what I put. I mean, if at all there is any, the antivirus I've installed, it is going through with that as well, because it is an open source package. Open source package do have, I mean, it can be vulnerable also, right? It can be malicious script as well. So all these things are getting checked at the background, and it is basically, downloading all the packages in the node module folder, which it is going to create next. So now, instead of, you know, waiting for this, as I said, I've already, you know, created. Let me just close it. Or let it run at the background, no problem. Let's go back to the project which I've already created for you, right? So this is how you will see. Once the project, once the node module folder will get installed, or once the project creation is done, then what you will see is, you will see a node module folder. If you see the difference between both the pages, just 1 minute, both the projects, just 1 minute. Let me just show you the difference between the both. Okay, if you see, yeah, if you see both of them, right, both are the similar sort of files, no change, right? Only difference you see is node module. Okay, if I show you the source folder means folder where we are going to code, folder where a developer is going to code. So the there's all files got, you know, created over here. If I also go into source folder, so see the same files, correct? The same files, right? So the project which I've already created for you for today's demonstration, right? This is also right from the scratch. And here you see node module folder is there. Now, what is there inside the node module folder? As I said, your node module folder contain all the required packages, all the required libraries with it. Now, question is, what libraries, what packages, where it is mentioned, right? Where we have mentioned that these are the packages I need for my Angular project when I create a new project, right? What I need after I have a project, it's a separate thing, right? But as of now, when I create a new project, where it is written that I need these packages, it is as good as when you're going to a pharmacy guy, right? Or a chemist, correct? You have a medical, you have a medicine prescription list. You have a prescription list that I need these medicine. So where is that prescription list? Where it is written that I need, okay, let me just show you the folder. So see, these many packages Node have installed. These many packages Node has to install when a new project is created. So where it is written that these many packages has to be installed? These are all medicines, right? Correct? So where is the prescription list? You got the medicine, but where is the prescription list? Let's see that. So to check that, what we'll do is, let's open this, this project. So now to open this project, what I need an editor. I need an editor where I can code, where I can develop, right? Where I can do my development, where I can check files, folders. So although I have not mentioned in here, but what you can do is, hold on. Note, you need an editor, right? Like Sublime. Pardon if spelling is mistake. Sublime, right? Or Atom. Or Eclipse, which means if you're working in Java, so you can pretty much use the same editor, Eclipse, because you guys are familiar with Eclipse, right? If you have, let's say, VS, Visual Studio, which is not an editor, it's an IDE, Integrated Development Environment. Visual Studio itself is a very good, very great thing. It contains an editor, right? It's a huge tool, right? So VS, if you have, please go ahead with the VS, no problem, if you're comfortable in that. But my favorite, and which is very hot in the market, right? Which is a lightweight and free of cost tool, is VS Code. VS Code means Visual Studio Code. So where you're going to find it is, let's open the browser and say Visual Studio Code. So the first link is the one which you need. This is the beautiful tool. What they've done is they have given all the front end intelligence. I mean, they have given intelligence related to CSS, related to preprocessor like CSS, LESS. They have given intelligence related to beautification, formatting, right? Linting, JavaScript, HTML, whatnot. I mean, you name any front end library or front end tool or front end technique or front end feature, they have it in their list, right? So Visual Studio Code is complete front end editor, right? So you can download for, again, you can download for Windows, you can download for Mac, you can download for Linux. It depends upon you which OS you belongs to, right? So again, Once you click on download for Windows, you will get to have MSI file. It'll ask you, yeah, exe, right? Again, save it, double click, next, no prerequisite, just say next, and done, right? Once you're done, once you install, let me just put this one in the setup document, right? To install, not install, to download VS Code, right? Okay. Now, as I said, once you install the Visual Studio Code, then in the start, in the startup page, you can see Visual Studio Code, correct? Click on it. Visual Studio Code, you go to File option, File, Open Folder, correct? Search for where you have your project, not repository, your project. You always need to go inside your project, not in the repository, right? So what you do is, this is our project, Learn Now Web, right? When I was creating it, that's the best name I got in my mind, Learn Now Web. So I put that name again. While showing you, I put the name My Basic A7. So project name can be anything, right? So I went into my project and opened it. So when you open your project, this is the look which you're going to see, right? And what we were discussing is, I'll first finish that point which I started, that from where Node is getting the information that I need to download these many packages. Means, where is that prescription list of medicine which a pharmacist or a chemist need to, pharmacy guy or a chemist need to have to give all the medicines, right? And node model folder is that envelope where a pharmacy guy or a chemist guy will add all the medicines, right? So these are all the medicines. Again, I'm repeating the same thing. These are all the medicines. But how? From where? We got how, but from where? Where it is written? So the answer is your packet.json, right? The packet.json is the file where it will mention, right? Where it will mention that these are the things that it has to download. So you can see dependency, under the dependency tag, they have mentioned Angular animation, Angular CDK, common, compiler, core, form, HTTP, right? Like core and common has all the common functionality. Form is having all the form-based functionality, like interacting with form, posting data from form to, you know, class, validation, interactive, reactive and template-based forms. Right, all the form-based functionality. Then HTTP package is there mentioned, which Node has already installed, right? This will have the required classes to set up the asynchronous call to our API, which I mentioned in the first half of this session. Platform browser for bootstrapping, you know, Angular material, third-party Angular library, which gives you all ready-made components, right? So we'll talk about it later. So like this, all the packages are there, right? In dev dependencies, I'll give you the explanation between the dev dependencies and dependency also. As of now, this is not a correct time to give the explanation. You may get confused also. Understand that dependencies and dev dependencies, both will be there in the node module folder, correct? But what will get used when, that is what I need to explain you, right? Which I will do it later. So dev dependencies also, you can see TypeScript, right? Very much important. So which version of TypeScript is installed? 3.1.6. When you will install, right? You may have the upper version of TypeScript. You may have the upper version of Angular CLI also. I am having 7.0.5. You may have, let's say 7.1.5, right? Because I have some 2 weeks back, I've updated my framework, Angular CLI framework. So I got the 7.0.5. Let's say yesterday they upgraded the minor version. So you may see a different, you know, package number, right? Okay. Now what next? Now you got an information that, you know, here, from here, basically all the package information is coming from here. This is the place where all the packages information is coming from, which means your npm will always read your packet.json and install these packages, these dependencies, into node model folder. Correct? If you wish to install any package from your side, right, you can always go to folder, say cd practice project training Angular, inside Angular you have here, you can say npm install. Let's say you want bootstrap, so npm install bootstrap, right, minus minus save means in your local project, in your project. If I say minus g, it is going to install bootstrap globally, remember? So minus g is for global, minus minus save is for your current project. So it is going to install bootstrap in my current project. I wanted to install jQuery. So this is like I am giving a medicine name to a pharmacy guy, that I need, let's say, brufen, right? I need crocin. So similarly, I'm telling node, right, that hey node, so npm install, please install npm install, node package manager install what? jQuery. Not install is the right word, download. So download jQuery to my local folder, right? Local project. Bootstrap to my local project, right? Angular material to my local project. Vue.js, sorry, not Vue.js. Any other library, whatever you want, right? TypeScript to my local project. So Angular has already all the required packages. Angular has already installed, correct? When you create a new project, the basic projects, basic packages, libraries already got installed. It will install it for you, right? It will install it for you in the node model folder. That is why it takes some 10 to 20 minutes time, right? Once that is done, now just like I showed you, if you wish to install further packages, you, with the help of this npm commands, right, which I npm install bootstrap minus minus save, like this, with the help of npm install command, you can install the packages, right? Now question is, what is the folder structure? Much before starting with the hands-on, right, you need to understand the folder structure. I will not go through with the entire folder structure in one shot, because that will spoil the mood, because we are already in a mood to have hands-on, right? Some coding, something, right? So if I start explaining you everything in one shot, the balance will not be there. So my idea is to give you a balanced knowledge, right, which will have theory and practical both. So just after packet.json, right, we'll not talk about angular.json file, which is very, very important file. It is like your build file, right, or which has your all build information, project information, correct? Just like you have web.config or web.xml, similarly we have angular.json in Angular project, right? Let's not talk about it as of now, because it is not important as of now. Okay, let's quickly jump on our source folder we are going to code, right? So we have app. Inside source folder we have app folder. App is the folder where you are going to add your modules, add your components, add your services, add your directives, add your pipes. Means whatever you do, you are going to do inside your app folder only, and there is no other place where you're going to do a code, right? So your app folder is your bread and butter, correct? Again, I've explained you the architecture in the first half of this session, but how the bootstrapping is happening, correct? So I have two ways. One, I can show you the bootstrapping. I mean, I'll explain you the bootstrapping first, again, theoretical concept, and then come back on practical. Or second way is, let's do something practical and try to have a feel of Angular, and then it will be easy for you to understand how the bootstrapping of the application is happening. Bootstrapping of the application means what is the first step that will trigger, and how the series of event will come into picture, and you will see your application there in the browser. Right? That is what we say bootstrapping, the complete setup of the application, that complete startup of the application, bootstrapping. Right from compilation till the execution or getting it on the browser. Right? This whole process is called bootstrapping, not the bootstrap CSS framework. Bootstrapping is a process. Right? So I wanted to throw some light on the practical straight away so that, as I said, we'll do some balance, right? So what I want is, I wanted to show you, okay, again, we go to app folder. Inside app folder, you can see by default, they have added four files. As I said, one will be your default module file. One will be your default component file, correct? Right? So, and where is the index.html page? So if you see outside, you have index.html page, right? This I only added for the practice. Let's remove it. You'll not have it like this. When you create a new project, this is how you're going to see. This is the look. This is going to be the look. Okay. This is your index page. Okay, so let's see from the index page, right? Let's try to have a quick bootstrapping, correct? Because I need to throw some light on bootstrapping, then only it will be easier for you to understand. I will not go in the bootstrapping process. I will not go in detail of bootstrapping process as of now in today's session, right? Let me just quickly throw some light on the bootstrapping. How exactly this happened? So when your index page will come into picture, right? When your application, first of all, when your application will come from the server once and for all and sit inside the browser, right? What happens next? So your index page will come into picture. Your index page, you can see in your index page, you have nothing. You have one selector, correct? Just like we have body, we have head, we have HTML. Just like that, you have selector called app root. So what is this selector? What is this selector? This selector is the name of your default component. Default component. Or you can say a parent component. A component which is a father and a mother of all components. The parent component. Right? What is the parent component? App component. And you can see its selector name. And remember in the theory, in the architectural diagram, I told you component, it's a fundamental unit of programming where you will have a template, at least a template and a class file. Do we have such things? Let's check. So if you see this component, I have a class file. You can see class file, class name called app component. And I have an HTML, right? Which is this component.html. So as I told you, your component will have at least one HTML page and a class. So you can see this is the path of the HTML page. Instead of writing a HTML page here itself, I have given a separate reference. So what I can do is I can put a comment and I can write a template, not template URL, template here itself. Welcome to Angular 7. Welcome to Learn Now. Right? Of course, comma is missing. So, as I said, your component will have at least one template, one HTML, at least one HTML and a class. So, this is your HTML, correct? And this is your class. This HTML is going to be visible to client, to user, end user. End user will see welcome to Learn Now, right? Learn Now. And this is the class file where we'll have all the dynamic part, right? Code behind file. Okay. Apart from these two, you see the selector app root. You see the selector app root, correct? My component name, my component selector name is, or my component selector is app root. You can give any name to it. You can give, let's say, instead of app root, you can give ln, learn now root, right? So obviously you need to change in index.html. Here you see ln root. This is I guess probably the only complex part for Angular to understand how it bootstrap basically. Once you understood this one, then rest will be piece of cake. Trust me. Right? So far, did you understand app component and how it is hooked in HTML? Index.html? Is this clear to you? Do you have question in that? I still not done with the bootstrapping. So consider that point. I've only explained you. First page will get loaded, which is index.html, of course. Inside that index.html, you have a tag called ln root. So I explain you what is ln root. Ln root is nothing but a selector name of my app component, which is a parent component, right? Which is a parent component. So just like, you know, we have component, I've already explained you the definition of component, that it will have at least one HTML and a class. So this is your component, which is having, you know, HTML and a class. And third thing, what you've seen is selector name by which it is getting called in index.html, right? So step one, index.html, step two, app component. Is that part clear, guys? Did you understand this? You can put it in the chat. I will love to hear from you. Is it clear to you? Yes or no? Great. I am getting the chat. Jay say yes. Ram is saying all clear. Komli saying all fine. Okay. Sain saying yes. So far is yes. Shilpa saying all good. Good. Great. So no problem, right? Step three. Step two done. Step three. This app component, right? As I said, it's a fundamental unit of programming. And in the architectural diagram also, I said that one module, your application will have at least one module, because module is a bigger thing. That is the one which will get bootstrapped first. And every module will have at least one component, correct? So where is the module file? So now if you see app module, correct? Now the Angular execution will check where is the module for it. App component, okay, I have a component, I got it, no problem. Now Angular execution process or Angular development server will check where this component is hooked up. In which file, what is the module file where this component is coming from? Because for bootstrapping, right? For bootstrapping, module is the thing. Module will get bootstrap or inject first, then all the components which hooked up with the module file will get injected. I mean, first module will go, and then all the components which will get called inside the module will get injected. So I am basically taking you from Z to A, right? So that when I start from A to Z again, you will understand very easily. It's an old method of explanation. It's an old method of counting as well. You count, you know, from first to last, right? And then you count from last to first if both the values are same, which means your counting is correct. So same way I'm using it over here. I'm explaining you from Z to A. I know it's bit odd, right? Taking it from in a reverse order, but this is how, browser process happens. And then I explain you A to Z. So now we need to find the module of app component. So I'm going to app module. So as I said, as of now, I don't have multiple module. I have only app module. So it is easy to find app module. So in the app module, if you see, you have a bootstrap property. I'll explain the rest of the things later. You will see bootstrap property, correct? Where we have mentioned app component, which means, which says that app module may have multiple components, but the startup component, the initial component, the component which index page should use or which index page is authorized to use is my app component. Correct? So that's the third step of your bootstrapping. Correct? Now question is, who is calling this app module file? Who is calling this app module file? From where this app module file itself is getting bootstrapped or initialized, right? So for that, I need to go to main.ts. Fourth and the last one, and then done. So main.ts. Again, if you know OOPS concept, that means you know C++, C#, Java, right? PHP also, you have a main method. Main method is always going to be the entry point of your application, correct? Similarly, you have main.ts. Your main.ts is an entry point of your application. So you can see over here, right? You see bootstrap module is app module. So what is these, or what all these imports are? So if you are from backend development like .NET, Java, PHP, right? You know, we use using or import, right, to import the packages. If you don't work in .NET, Java, PHP, if you know C++ also, C also, correct? Again, you will find it's the same thing. In C, C++, which is a basic, which every engineer has learned in his academics, right? Where you see include Conio, include Studio means header files, packages, namespaces, right? So it's the same thing over here. Import instead of include or using, right, or require, we are using import. So import keyword is going to import these files, correct, and put it over here. So if you see import enable prod mode, right, it is importing from the package called angular/core. Now question is, did we install in our project? Answer is yes. We have already installed in our project. And where it is located as of now, it is there in node module folder. Correct? So in the import, we give the path and we ask, like, what exactly in the curly braces we mention what exactly we want to import. Right? So again, I mean, these things we'll see later, right? As of now, not required. Enable prod mode, as of now, I mean, you have no concern with it. Don't worry about it and don't even think about it. Important package is this platform browser dynamic, because platform browser dynamic will have a bootstrap module function where you will pass the module. So, but to pass the module, I need to import it. So if you see these two, I mean, step one, if I need to, let's say, present it in step. So step one and step two is, step one is import platform browser, dynamics. Correct. You need this class. You can mouse over and check. So this is constant. You need this constant, right, to do a bootstrapping. Okay. And what you need to bootstrap, which module you need to bootstrap, because in your application, you might have hundreds of module, which module? So app module, if that is so, then import app module. So how are you going to import app module? I mean, if I delete it and try to import fresh, so I say import statement. So I say ./, right? Or just say /, will work? No. So ./ app / app module. Right, so this is the path, and what I wanted to, what I wanted to import, app module, right, app module. So step two, app module. Now I'm done. Step one, step two done. Now let's code, which is step three. Step three, so I say browser platform dynamic, correct, dot bootstrap module. And bootstrap module, I will put that which module I wanted to bootstrap, which is my startup module, which is my parent module. So app module, I mentioned app module class name, correct? And then I have a function for catch. If at all you are not able to inject or initialize app module, that if there is some error, then you will throw an exception. So now if you see, index one, app component, app module, and main.ts, right? Now see it from A to Z. So first it hits the first main.ts will load. Now see it from the bootstrapping perspective. I mean from index, app component, app module, and main.ts was from the browser perspective. Now let's see from the bootstrapping perspective. First of all, in this bootstrapping process, what is going to be your first file is your main.ts. Main.ts is the entry point of your application. From this point, actually, programming execution pointer will enter in. Right? Just like we have main method in C, C++, C#, Java. So this is the entry point. So from here, you will get to know, okay, we need to have app module as our startup module file or base module file, right? We need to load app module file. So then the pointer go to step two, app module. So this is our app module file. In app module file, we may have so many components like, let me just type some sample. So component one, like this, hold on, component A, like this, I may have multiple component, because that is what I told you in your module file. Your module file represents a feature can have n number of functionality. Every functionality will be represented by a component. So you may have n number of component over here, component A, B, C, D, E, F, anything. Out of these many components, when you create a component, you have to put it in the declaration array. Right? All the components you have to put in the declaration array. So you have mentioned all the components in the declaration array. Out of these components, you have to choose your startup component. So I said app component is my startup component. Correct. So my entry point was main.ts. In the main.ts, it is written that you need to inject or load, or what is your startup module? So app module. In app module, I got to know I have n number of components, but my bootstrap means my startup component is going to be app component. When this will load, the whole app component functionality will load. Your class will load of app component. Your HTML will load of app component, right? Let's not go in this sess as of now. I'm just removing it. Right? And your component, this component will load, which has a HTML. This is the HTML. This is the class file. Correct? And this is the selector name of it. Now, once this is loaded, your bootstrapping done. Now again we jump on the browser from browser perspective. Now when browser will ask for, just be there. Now when browser will, when the index page will load in the browser, index page will look for ln root. Okay, what is ln root? It's a name of my app component. So now the question is, do I have app component loaded in the browser? Yes, it is loaded, because bootstrapping is already have been done, right? This app component belongs to which module? App module. Is this also loaded? Yes. When the bootstrapping happened, this app module is also loaded. Where it is mentioned? In main.ts, it is mentioned that app module has to be a startup module that has to get loaded in the browser, or which is or in the bootstrapping process. So that is also done. So did you get my point, guys? Did you understand from A to Z and Z to A how bootstrapping is happening, or how the browser is loading it? Did you understand from both the perspective? Okay, I guess we have a question from Jay. Yes, Jay, go ahead, ask your question.
So Ajay, so the condition is like from the bootstrapping point, it will basically load all the classes. Assuming that
Correct.
I'm basically talking from the Java perspective, it's basically
Correct.
like, okay, it will basically compile and load all the on the server startup. That's basically when you say ng server start, and that time it will basically load in all the dependencies, right? And that's what you process defined it like. It will basically first look into this, and then from
Correct.
Browser perspective, it's basically going to render it, right? And while rendering, it basically it will just go and keep on checking that what else is dependent. Let's go and render it. Pick it.
Correct.
Pick
Correct.
It. Okay. Okay.
Absolutely correct. So
yeah,
I will
exactly.
extend Jay's point, right? So remember, I told you in the first session of first half of the session that you as a programmer is going to code in TypeScript, correct? You as a programmer is going to code in TypeScript when you compile your project, right? When you compile your project and you want to and you wish to see the output in the browser, then in the compilation process, your TypeScript compiler, right, will take all these TS files. You can see app this main.ts, appmodel.ts, component.ts. It'll take all your TS file, convert into JavaScript. Correct. So now after compilation, what you have as an output is JavaScript, HTML and pure CSS. That is what is going to go to browser. That is what is going to settle inside the browser. Correct. And that is what your browser will show on the screen. So your browser never ever understand your TypeScript. As of now, browser is having no capability of understanding TypeScript. Correct? Your browser can only understand JavaScript, HTML and CSS. That is the smartness that Angular guys have done, the Google has done. They have designed this framework in such a way that the developers will develop it just the way they're developing their user story in .NET, in Java, in PHP, in C++. Correct? They will not feel any difference. So that they can learn better, they can learn fast. But browser doesn't understand all these things, right? All these technical part. Browser doesn't understand your preprocessor. Browser doesn't understand your Angular, your TypeScript. Browser only understand four simple things: HTML, CSS, JavaScript, and XML, right? It has parser for these four things also only. So your Angular, framework, when you're compiling, it is converting every, preprocessor like CSS, LESS, SASS, or your TypeScript into JavaScript, right? CSS and JavaScript. So that's it about the bootstrapping part, right? Now, obviously you wish to see the output of it, isn't it? Like how it is going to look like, how application is going to look like, how will start the compilation time, compilation, correct? So if you notice, just before that step, I just wanted to add, one more point. I know too much of information is also harmful, but this is worth it. If you open main.ts. If you open main.ts, no, not main.ts. I open app module. If you open app module, you will see class. App module is also class, right? If you open app component, you will see app component is also class, right? If you create any service, you will see that is also class. So now you understood that why I was saying that TypeScript is basically OOPS based. Everything in the TypeScript file, whatever TS file you create, that is your class only. That is your class. But you can change the behavior of the class by adding the decorator and the metadata inside it. That is where my architecture diagram will come into picture. You see this metadata? See the metadata? In service also, you will find metadata, correct? Here they have not written, but service also we have metadata. So everything in TypeScript, 99% you will find class only. Only 1% you will be finding interfaces or enums or constant, right? Otherwise, majority of the things are classes only. But you can see the behavior of the class, you can say got changed. Apart from class, they have the extra burden, extra functionality as well. So that got added with the help of decorator. So if I put decorator called component, then this class will become a component. If I add decorator as ng model, now this app module class will become a module file, right? Okay, how you will differentiate this is a component, this is module, this is service with the help of decorator. But internally, it's a class only. On top of class feature, you are saying this class should behave like module. Okay, go ahead, put module decorator. This class should behave like a component. Go ahead, add a component decorator. This class should behave like a service. So go ahead, add a injectable decorator on top of it, right? And change the behavior of a class. Correct? Right? And to add this decorator, you will use the import, of course. First of all, you need to import it, just like you do file referencing, and then you have to use it. And inside these decorators, yes, Jay, I'm coming to a point. And inside these decorators, you will find some information. That information is called metadata. So if this class is a component, if you wanted to make this app component class as a component, so add a component decorator and provide the metadata, like what is the HTML of this component? What is the HTML of this component class? What is the selector name of this component class? What is the styles? What are the styles in this component class, right? Getting a point? Like this, there are so many other properties as well, so many other metadata as well. So this is the basic one. So I'm just sticking to the basic as of now for this session. Right? Yes, yeah, go ahead, please.
You answered my question. My question was like, we have a metadata. So as you said, like it's a component and ng module is the two metadata. Like this, how many metadatas are we have?
Okay.
It's around so many. I'm talking about the popular metadata, which basically every Angular developer should know.
Okay, so you're talking about these properties named as selector, template.
Like no, not selector template is different.
I understood. So say decorators. No, understood. So say decorators. How many decorators we have? So right. We have component decorator. We have injectable decorator. We have module decorator. We have directive decorator. We have pipe decorator. Right? These five are the most popular one. So if you wanted to create.
Yeah. Is the router is also going to be a decorator or it's like a...
No, router is not a decorator.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah. And the other question is like export. When you say, because everything is a class, but in every class, we are just basically the new thing
export.
That we are seeing.
Very good question. Thanks you asked this question. So if you see for every class, they put export. Why they put export is so that they can import it in a different file. So if you see this component, this app component, I say export. Because I say export, that is why in the app module file, I'm able to import it. Got my point? I'm able to import app component in app module file because it is exportable. And now see the same thing, same answer for app module also. App module is a class. I put export. Why? So that in main.ts I can import it. See? Does that answer your question?
But do they have any other thing? It's basically like that's, that means in Angular everything is going to be exported. It's or
correct.
Do we have a case?
Let me give this example. So let's say one more thing.
Like maybe like if I'm not like going very aggressive, if not like maybe like you are covering in a later part of the
that's
code.
That's what I wanted to take it step by step. So
yes,
let's say you wanted to add instead of making four different file, instead of making three different file, component, module, and main TS, you wanted to make only one TS file, which is highly unlikely. You must not do it. All the functionality should be segregated in different file. But let's say, for example, you wanted to make only one TS file where you wanted to define app component also, app module also, and main.ts also. So in that case, you don't need export for the class. Why? Because you are calling within the same file, right? So which prove my point that export is used when you want to play between different physical files. Got my point? Mm-hmm. So let's say you wanted to, you know, call your module file, let's say this module section, you wanted to put it here itself, right, like this. So now you don't need export in the component, because within the file itself you are using app component class, right? Which is highly unlikely. You will not be doing it. You should not.
So
do
that
it.
Means that means that is basically not advisable, right?
That is not advisable. Yes.
Okay.
That is not at all advisable.
Mm-hmm. Then what are the cases that they basically need an export and they don't need an export? Because in Angular, if you say it's a single page application, that's what they say. And if it is a single page application, that means we should not be everything is an export. Whether you export it or you consume in the same class, right? Mm-hmm. If you consume in the same class, then it's fine. But why they have added an export? The question is like they should have mandatory made it like Angular. In Angular, all classes will be exported by default.
No. It's not like that. You have to put export keyword, then only they will get export. I'll tell you what are the.
I understood Ajay that part. Mm-hmm. What I'm trying to understand is like, what was the reason they basically added an export keyword instead of like because if export that the two purpose that you said told us, right? One mm-hmm. thing is basically you wanted to import somewhere. Mm-hmm. That's one purpose. Other purpose, if you don't put an export, you can just take that part of the code and then put that into the code wherever you are using it, right?
Correct.
Now, assuming that if that's an Angular behavior, mm-hmm. I'm saying is that if that's a default behavior, so why can't they do the same thing into the, they can basically default this is to be export only. They left it on
us that how we wanted to use it. They didn't put anything by default, correct?
Okay.
They put it on us that how you wanted to use it. That is what I was about to explain you with the example. Let's say I add a class called employee, right? It's a simple class, and this will have some property. Let's say name property. It's a string, right? Now point is I wanted to create a class within this TS file. And I wanted to use it. So now to use this class, I don't need to put export to it. So they will be, they left it on us that, you know, you want it in document class, or you want, you know, external document class. So if it is external document class, use export. If it is in document, you don't need to. So they completely put it on us that how we want to, you know, use it. That's why they didn't put anything default. Right.
It's, in other words, basically they wanted to provide a user to benefit from the modularity.
From like the modularity from the framework, yes.
Code reusability, right?
Correct. From code perspective.
Okay. Yeah. Yes.
Now let's see the last thing for the session. That is how I'm going to compile it. So let's say I am in the app component. In an app component, you see I have a title. And title says Learn Now Web. I say welcome. Okay, I'm already having some static data. So I'll show you the dynamic part also. But I'm already having a static data. Let's say this is my component. This is the only component I have. I wanted to see the output of it. So all this coding I've done in TypeScript. Now this has to get compiled into JavaScript. So what is the command for it? So what you'll do is, you have in Visual Studio Code, this is again one benefit, you have inbuilt command prompt. You don't need to open an existing, an external one and do it. You have internal also. So I'll leave it on you, you know, which one you wanted to use. So I'm using the external one. I showed you the external one. Let's see the internal one also. So you go to view, and in the view you will have terminal, right? So this will open your terminal. Best part is you can add any number of terminals. Correct? Let's delete it. Okay. So now the command is ng serve. So serve. So ng serve basically is the command which is mentioned in the packet.json. You can go to packet.json. One second. Packet.json. So apart from dependency, you can see some scripts has been written over here. Ng serve. It is Angular command. Start is a node command. So if I say npm start, then I'm hitting a node command. So node will internally use ng serve. Ng serve is an Angular command, right? That is why I told you your Angular works on top of node. Your Angular need node to work. Correct? So if I pass this ng serve command, so you can see what has done. See, it proves my point that all the TypeScript file, I mean all the files, types of file, TS files where I have code or I have coded as a developer, they got converted and bundled up as main.js. Correct? Leave polyfill.js and runtime.js as of now. All these styles got bundled up as style.js. All the npm packages, I mean all these dependencies which is required. All these dependencies which is required, because these dependencies has to go to browser so that browser can able to, you know, run the Angular code, right? So these dependency also has to turn into JavaScript. So all the dependencies, which is there in TS, got converted into JavaScript, bundled up and became as vendor.js, right? And to run this entire process, correct? Like this hooking part on the fly, running the code, for that we have this runtime.js. So by putting ng serve, you can see all the TS files has been converted into JavaScript. So now when I hit my browser will get pure JavaScript, right? That is what I was talking about. So you can see what, while I was when I hit this command ng serve, it has given me the message that Angular live development server is listening on localhost 4200, which means my Angular has used the node server, correct, and hosted my application. My Angular live development server has hosted my application on localhost 4200. So I can let's click this, or you can go to browser. Here and say localhost 4200. So you can see welcome to learn now is printed. Let me show you the inspect element so that I can show you the process which happened, right? The same index page which I was talking about, the same index page from where I started my story. So index page, index.html will come into picture, will load in the browser. And there I've mentioned ln root, right? Learn now root, that's my selector name of app component, right? And whatever HTML is there in app component, that got added here. So just 1 minute, what I will do is I'll go back in my app component, right? And I try to add, let's add something else as well. I put H2. And say we are learning Angular 7 full stack development, right? And save it. So my ng serve always, you can see it started compiling again. So you don't need to refresh the browser, or you don't need to put the ng serve command again, because ng serve always work in the watch mode. Watch mode means the moment you change something and save, it will compile that file, right? And again, it will update the, see, main.js got updated. So now when I go back to my browser will also automatically refresh and says we are learning Angular 7 full stack development again, right? Now I go back and put a conventional name instead of, ln root. Let's say I wanted to say app root, because it's app component, app root, right? Or ln app root. Let's say this is the selector name I put. So if I change the selector name here, obviously in the index.html, let me save it. Now it should give me an error. Why? because my, see, selector ln app root did not match any element because your index page is looking for ln root selector, right? And there is no selector by this name. There is no component by this name. So I can go to index.html and there I can change the name. I'm showing you all these nitty gritties so that you will understand actually what is happening. Nothing is thumb rule, right? You need to, it's pure hooking or referencing, correct? You reference it incorrectly, it will not work. You reference it correctly, it will work, right? Now again, it got compiled, which means my browser also get refreshed. I go back and again, it started working. All good? Any question? Then I will throw the last dice. Yeah.
Okay. If you're done, then we can sum up the question later on.
Okay. Now this is pure hard coded. I mean, in the HTML itself, I am putting everything, right? Two things. I've used HTML template, which means I'm doing all the code within the template, correct? Which shouldn't be the case. It's not recommended. Why? Because your HTML may be huge. Let's imagine you have a 2000 line of code or let's say 100 line of code also. Now just imagine 100 line of code like this. Will you be able to, you know, code it properly with the formatting or proper beautification and formatting? Answer is no. Will you be able to use IntelliSense? Answer is no. Will you be able to, you know, maintain it? Answer is no. 2, 3, 5, 10, 15 lines. Okay. I can still buy it. But if you're expecting, some 20, 30 line of at least 20, 30 line of component HTML code also, you should not be doing it, you know, within the template. What you should do is let's comment this. You should have a separate HTML page, right? We name it app dot, by default it got name app.component.html. You can put aj.component.aj.html as well. Let me just show you. I'm renaming it. I'm saying aj.learnnow.html, right? And what we can do is, as I said, it's pure file referencing. So instead of in the template URL, I can mention learnnow.html, right? Let's save it. So what is there in learnnow.html? Do we have anything there? So yes, we have at least hello all, right? So now hello all should print, correct? Because I have given a reference HTML reference file. Correct, which is as good as you creating it over here, but not recommended. Recommended is you should always have a separate HTML file which you hook it in the component so that you can have all the intentions. For example, the moment you wanted to type P, see, paragraph came, say, hi, we are learning Angular 7. Save it. See? Hello all, we are learning Angular 7. Correct, team? Now, as I said, the last roll of dice, which is, let me just put this one in two halves. If you see, I have a class, but am I using my class properties? No. I will explain the class in the next session. Next week, Saturday, right? But I would just wanted to show you something so that your interest will be there, because you might be having a question in your mind that we don't put, you know, hard coded value in HTML. We take value. I mean, it should come from DB, right? As per the architecture, as per the, you know, project flow, data should come from DB, from DB to API, API to service, service to component class, component class to HTML. That is the flow I've explained you. If you see this one, that is the flow I've explained you. From DB, data will go to API. API will pass the data to our Angular service. Angular service will inject it in component class. From component class, with the help of property binding, it should show on the template. So obviously, as of now, I don't have DB, I don't have API, I don't have service, but I do have component. So in the component class, I do have component class. In the component class, let's assume data title value is coming from from DB, right? I mean, from service, so service to API, API to DB. So DB to API, API to Angular service to finally here in component class, correct? The idle value is coming from service, Angular service. API, which can be in .NET, Java, PHP, Node. API can be in any technology, and DB, of course. That's the flow. DB to API to service, and finally coming in here. This welcome is coming from, assume it is coming from DB. Now I got the data. I have a property. I've created a simple property called title. Let me show it in a better way. So title, it's a string type. Okay, I will explain or tell you how many type of data type we have in TypeScript, right? But looking at this, why I'm putting emphasis on this one is, looking at this, you will definitely remember or recall your .NET, your C#, your Java, your PHP, your C++, because there also we have variable type and variable, correct? The only difference is, in those server-side scripting languages, we put type first and then variable. Here, we declare it like this: title, variable name, it is of string type, correct? It is of string type. And then I can say, I can have constructor, just like every class has a constructor, every class has a right to have a constructor, isn't it? Not a new thing for you. I say this dot title equals to welcome to learn now, right? This is my title. So again, all the front-end guys, all the back-end guys, you should not feel anything change over here, because in the class, you do create properties, which I did here. You do have constructor, which I did here, right? You do use this operator. This represents the current class. So yes, I've also used this dot title, correct? If I have one more, say version, and I say version variable should be of number type, version property should be of number type, great. Now I can say this dot version, see, version is again second property, so in this it has to come. I say 7, right? So I have now two properties which has a data. Now I want to hook these properties. Let me show it to diagram, last 2 minutes and then we're done. Now these two properties have to get hooked in the HTML, right? Title and version, right? So let's try to do it. How? I'll keep these arrows here. So I'll say like this. I say strong, it's an HTML tag. Okay, don't worry about it, it's an HTML tag. I say course name, again hard-coded value, but how I'm going to have span is again HTML tag, right? I put a placeholder and say title. Right? I say title and I put a placeholder, curly braces, open, close. Now again, these curly braces, open, close, also not the new thing for you. In Angular, we call it interpolant, but it's a, they say it's a new thing, but it's a bluff, right? Because this is nothing but a placeholder, right? Which is again, not the new thing for you. In your .NET, C#, you have placeholder concept. In your Java also, you have placeholder concept. What placeholder does? Placeholder basically holds the place of the variable, correct? Technically, placeholder holds the place of the variable. Even in C also, you have a placeholder. Remember those days, your academic days, where you have %i, %s, %a, right? Remember? %i, %a, %s, placeholder. It will hold the place of your variable. Correct? So again, not a new thing for you. So we have this curly braces, open close. In Angular language, we call it interpolate. It is going to interpolate your variable, your property, your class variable, your class property, which is title. So it is going to print the value of your title property. And I put a line break, br, line break, next line, and say strong, say Angular version, or in fact, I say version space. I saved it. So by now, this title has already got printed. And then span, in the span, again, curly braces, I put version. Again, in it is case sensitive, so save it. Let's see, will these two things get printed or not? Where is the browser? Yeah, here is the browser. So in the browser, you can see title, welcome to Angular now, welcome to learn now, and version is 7. If you just put a mouse over on it, if you see an inspect element, correct? Okay, how you open this inspect element, you right click and you press inspect. Or press F12, you will get this browser console window. There, the first one is the element where you can check the DOM, document object model, your page, your HTML page in short, right? So here you see, it's a neat and clean code. No predefined tags, no technology specific tags, right? Correct? So I put this welcome to learn now is coming from the class, but there is no specific predefined tag there that they have injected, the Angular framework has injected in the span, nothing, pure value, right? That's also makes it more faster, and performance wise also better, this Angular framework, because they're not adding any prefix in the DOM, which the earlier version of Angular used to do it. Correct? It's a dynamic value. So which means if I quickly go ahead and say course, course, so string type, and here I said this dot course, course equals to Angular, right? Save. So I can put one br over here, line break, and let me just quickly copy paste. Where instead of title, I say course name, and value, I say course, course. Saved it. So now I should see that as well. See, course name Angular version 7. So what do you say, guys? Isn't it beautiful? Isn't it awesome? Right? How simple programming is if you know OOPS concept. If you have a fair bit of idea of class concept also, that's all you need in Angular. That's all you required in Angular. That is the only prerequisite for Angular, right? Correct? You don't need to learn anything new. What you will see in this course is Angular is doing the same thing what you have been using in your server-side technology or in your front-end technology. But what is the benefit of Angular is everything they have combined. So if you have Angular in your web project, you have all the goodness of your server side technologies as well as front end technologies. So that is why Angular is one single framework which has all the goodness of front end and front end libraries and the server side technologies. Correct? That is why you don't need anything else apart from Angular in your web project. But if you see other technologies, you need server side technology plus you need some client side library as well. For example, if you're working in Java, you need jQuery to support. If you're using .NET, you need jQuery to support, or any third party jQuery library to support, or any third party JavaScript library to support, right? But if you choose Angular, you have the goodness of all front end side library and the backend side library, the server side library, right? And the code is absolutely neat and clean. And in 5 or 6 session itself, you will be, I always used to call it overnight. In overnight, you will be turning into a UI developer, right? Where you, if you choose some other technology, you take time to, you know, grasp the technology, know the integrity of the technology, know the syntax of the technology, right? Which of course take time, but learning curve over here is huge, but the time span is very short, correct? Yes, so I open the forum now for questions. So if you have question, please go ahead and ask. You can put your question by unmuting yourself also. You can put it in the chat window as well.
So I have a few questions, yeah, sure. Ajay. The first one, when you were showing that like the package.web, basically you said ng serve and it's basically tied to start.
Mm-hmm.
And you were saying something related with Node.js. I just wanted to go to that page again and see that like what trying to understand, like
you want me to open package.json?
Yes, package.json, and that's where
let me just
ng serve, right? You said on command line you can say
yes,
and that basically interrelate with the Node.js, Node package manager. Not Node package manager, it's basically the ng start, right? It's basically what it does basically. I just wanted to understand the process again. Maybe you already explained, I just wanted to
yes. Look. So I said these scripts are basically NPM scripts. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So if I kill the server, if I control C, and if you want to close, you close. If I say npm start, so okay. These scripts are npm scripts, npm command.
Okay.
And their value is Angular command. As I told you earlier, that Angular cannot do it alone. Angular need Node server. In fact, for that matter, any front-end library or framework need Node to to support with the server facility, because
so that
no
means, okay, that means irrespective of whether it is Angular or any JavaScript,
correct. You need Node.
Framework, so whether it is Active, React and all, anything, they need a Node.js,
correct,
right?
Correct. Because no front-end library has a server inbuilt. Okay, they need a server. So instead of going with Tomcat, Apache, IIS server, right, going into different technology stream, they choose Node because Node is irrespective to any technology. Node itself is an open source server, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Where any front-end library can make use of Node and host their application. So if I say npm start, now see what will happen. Npm start will trigger ng serve command. You can see that, right?
Yeah, right.
So if I pass ng serve, I'm directly interacting with Angular, right? If I say npm start, then I'm interacting with Node, I mean npm, and npm in turn is interacting to Angular.
Okay.
Like this, so we have other commands also, like build, test, lint, e2e. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So npm, when we say npm start, that basically instructs npm node package manager, okay, go and start the server.
Mm-hmm.
So can we deploy, as you said, like there are other Apache and other ISS, these are the server side applications. So can we deploy Angular application in Apache also?
Good question. In fact, the awesome one. Yes, answer is yes. You can deploy it Apache, you can deploy it IIS. As I said, I'll show you now also. If you see Node server, as I said, it is a local development server. So for development, you need Node. But for deployment, you don't need Node. How? Let me just show you. So let's say you are done with your code and now you wanted to deploy it. So how you wanted to deploy? Point is, you need a package, right? You need a deployable files, which ng-serve is not giving you. Ng-serve is doing a local development and hosting your site locally in the Node server. So there's one more command you can see, build, ng-build. So what ng-build will do is, it will create a dist folder. As of now, there's no dist folder, you can see. It will create a dist folder, destination folder, which is a deployable folder. Just hold on for a minute. So it is compiling. So once this is done, you will find a dist folder, almost done. Okay. See now. Can you see in the left hand side corner? You have a dist folder, which was not there previously. Now, if you open this dist folder, let me open it in, Explorer. Now, if you open this dist folder, you will find this folder. So now copy these files, right? And paste it in the web server. Either it is Tomcat, Apache, or IIS server, or whatever.
either so that call, inside the web app, right?
Correct. So hold on. Okay. If it is IIS server, you are going to paste these files into www root folder. If it is Tomcat, Apache, or Linux server, you will be having HTTPS folder, if I'm not wrong, HTTPS or HTTP doc folder, where you can put all these files, right? If copy paste is not your cup of tea or it's not the recommended thing, you can use the integrated development server like Jenkins server or Dismy. Jenkins will give a build on behalf of you. Dismy will deploy it on behalf of you, right? So I'm talking about copy paste. Dismy will also do the copy paste. It will take this build folder and deploy it on the web server. Correct?
Correct.
So this is deployable file.
Correct. Yeah.
Right? And if I, right click, open the main.js file into Notepad++, you will find all, this is our pure JavaScript code, which is going to server.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
Webpack is integrated with Angular.
Don't explain it. It's going to be like little no problem. Heavy.
No issues.
Okay.
Right. So that's it about the how we code in Angular. To extend the Angular session, right? I mean the class, how we work in the class, to extend it further, cover all the basic concepts of Angular, then jump on the dynamic, advanced part of Angular, including the live project that we're going to start from 29th of June. I hope that should be enough to convince you that why you should learn Angular and how easy it is to make any live project right in Angular. That is the proof of concept we're going to do. We're going to make a social networking site like LinkedIn and Facebook. It's a merger of LinkedIn and Facebook, right? We're going to have all social tabs. I've already explained what will be there in social networking site called We Build Nation in my first recorded session. So you can go through with it and understand what we're going to build. So it'll come up like a social networking site where people can connect to each other. That site with full stack development, we are going to do in Angular 7. This will be a first site of its own kind, which is there in Angular 7. So far, Facebook is built in PHP. LinkedIn is built in PHP. They are getting a support from React.js. When we will be able to complete the site and deploy it, we will be the first of our own kind who has deployed the whole social networking site like Facebook, like LinkedIn in AngularJS, right? I mean, the Google itself will be very proud on us, right?
Right.
With the full stack development, of course. No, not only Angular stuff. It will be having UX, UI. It will be having Angular material, database, APIs, Angular 7, of course, everything. So I am looking forward to, for the session from 29th of June.
I think. I'm more excited. I'm more excited to have a full stack.
And it's going to be a beautiful, sessions. Trust me, you're going to learn and develop. I mean, that is the word I use, build, learn and build. I mean, we'll learn and immediately we'll apply, build, learn and build, right? So that it'll not be a POC, it'll be a live project. Whatever you're learning, you're putting it in the live project, right? So we have Akash who joined late. Akash, can you just ping me your email address or phone number so that I can touch base with you? So I guess I got it. Okay, so you have my number, Akash? Let me just put it on the chat. That is my number, Akash. Just save it. And that's it for my side, guys. Let's see, on 29th of June, how we're going to start. As I said, I'm very excited and looking forward to see you guys over there. Right? This recording will be available after 1 hour. I'm going to ping you the link of this recording and the previous as well. Right? So Akash is saying email only. Yeah, email ID. Email ID should be fine, Akash.
You want me to, you have my email ID, right?
I have your email ID. I have your number also. I mean, I can ping you over there as well, right?
Correct. Yeah. Thank you.
So bye team.
Bye. Next class is going to Saturday, right? Saturday?
Absolutely. Saturday, 29th of June. That is the starting time of the project.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Bye, team. Bye.
That was nice.